After proposing independence, the Virginia Convention asked George Mason, a self-educated planter from Fairfax County, to draft a Declaration of Rights and Principles. Mason used the English Bill of Rights and the natural law principles made popular by John Locke as the foundations for what he wrote. The Declaration also reflected his feelings regarding slavery. Though a slave owner, Mason favored the abolition of the slave trade. He once referred to slavery as that slow poison which is daily contaminating the minds and morals of our people. The first paragraph of Mason's Declaration read, "All men are born free and independent, and have certain inherent natural rights of which they cannot, by any compact, deprive or divest their posterity, among which are the enjoyment of life and liberty, with the means of acquiring and possessing property, and pursuing and obtaining happiness and safety." Members of the convention were appalled. Robert Carter Nichols and others objected loudly. The first article was inconsistent with the state of slavery then existing in Virginia. To claim the equality of men would abolish that institution. Thomas Ludwell Lee, Richard Henry Lee's brother, wrote to him explaining that a certain set of aristocrats, finding that their execrable system cannot be reared on such foundations, have to this time kept this at bay on the first line, which declares that all men to born equally free and independent. Most historians believe that Mason did not mean to address the institution of slavery. They say Mason was addressing Virginia's claims against England, the same claims John Adams had been making in Massachusetts. The British were out to enslave them. The Virginia delegates were caught in a catch-22. The draft had already been made public and was well known. They couldn't simply erase the first article. That would tell the world that Virginia was seeking independence to protect slavery. But they also could not adopt it without change, because the slaveholders correctly feared that to do so would mean it could be used to abolish slavery. Judge Edward Pendleton came to the rescue. He deleted the word born and inserted the phrase when they enter a state of society. Their inherent natural rights were now only inherent. The new article read, "All men are equally free and independent, and have certain inherent rights, of which, when they enter a state of society, they cannot, by any compact, deprive or divest their posterity, namely, the enjoyment of life and liberty, with the means of acquiring and possessing property, and pursuing and obtaining happiness and safety." Since slaves were by definition not part of society, and had none of the rights Mason enumerated, no one had to worry. The edited version passed unanimously on June 12, 1776. Meanwhile, in Philadelphia, on June 23rd, Congress appointed Thomas Jefferson to draft the National Declaration of Independence. A trip between Williamsburg and Philadelphia took 5 days. As a Virginian, Jefferson thought that drafting Virginia's new constitution was more important than the business taking place in Philadelphia. Couriers kept Jefferson and the rest of the Virginia delegation abreast of the debates. News of the adoption and text of Virginia's Declaration of Rights would have been in Jefferson's hands. He already knew of the uproar Mason's original draft had caused. He also had seen the modifications. Jefferson did not want to repeat Mason's mistakes. Jefferson carefully studied the different drafts. Pendleton's modification, "when they enter a state of society," contradicted the natural rights theory on which the colonies had based their revolution. Jefferson knew he had to draft a document that Northerners and Southerners would both approve. Excluding slavery, as was done in the Virginia Declaration, would not work. Britain would certainly accuse the colonies of declaring independence so they could enslave blacks. Ensuring the right to obtain and possess property would confirm the accusation, since slaveholders perceive slaves as property. Jefferson concluded that the problem with the Virginia Declaration was the precise nature of its language. He decided to use language that was more ambiguous and less likely to raise objections. For Masons born, Jefferson used created, which did not specify the process of birth by a woman. He said that all men were created equal. This elevated the source of rights to a god or nature, which was in line with the principle of natural laws. What happened after creation was not discussed. He did not list all of man's rights with any specificity. They were only among these rights. Finally, he removed any mention of property. Instead, he inserted the phrase pursuit of happiness, which might include the acquisition of property or anything else like good health and education, etc. Balancing his views about human nature and the worth of humanity, Jefferson managed to protect the interests of slaveholders without enshrining slave property in the Declaration. The result was the poetic language that resonated around the world. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, that they are endowed by their Creator with certain unalienable rights, that among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, that to secure these rights, governments are instituted among men, deriving their just powers from the consent of the governed, that whenever any form of government becomes destructive of these ends, it is the right of the people to alter or to abolish it, and to institute new government, laying its foundation on such principles and organizing its powers in such form as to them shall seem most likely to affect their safety and happiness. The one time Jefferson did criticize slavery in the Declaration is the warfare of the Christian King of Great Britain, determined to keep open a market where men should be bought and sold. This phrase condemned foreign slave trade, which Virginia had publicly opposed since 1772, partly because increasing the number of foreign slaves would decrease the value of the domestic market, and also because Virginia might become like South Carolina, where the slave population outnumbered white, making the population more difficult to control. He is now exciting those very people to rise up in arms among us. The second part capitalized on the fear Lord Dunmore's call for slaves to rebel against their masters and defend the empire. The clause was removed. Jefferson explained the deletion. The clause reprobating the enslaving the inhabitants of Africa was struck out in compliance to South Carolina and Georgia, who had never attempted to restrain the importation of slaves, and still wished to continue it. Northern brethren also, I believe, felt a little tender under those censures. They have been pretty considerable carriers of them to others. Mansfield's decision in Somerset lurks within the list of grievances Jefferson presented in the Declaration's body. He accused the king of conspiring with Parliament to enact pretended legislation and declaring themselves invested with power to legislate for us in all cases whatsoever. This clearly references the Declaratory Act of 1766 and its threat, after Somerset, to slavery. Jefferson repeats this grievance in, "We have warned them from time to time of attempts by their legislature, Parliament, to extend an unwarranted jurisdiction over us. That unwarrantable jurisdiction included the Somerset case, the Declaratory Act of 1766, and the repugnancy clause of the colonial charters. The decision to make preservation of slavery a casus belli for the revolution began when John Adams agreed to the wishes of the Southern delegates for the sake of national unity at the First Continental Congress in 1774. It was kept by Jefferson and the delegates at the Second Continental Congress with the Declaration of Independence. Though overlooked and often dismissed by historians as a cause for independence and the American Revolution, slavery was integral. If Mansfield had not ruled in favor of Somerset, and Parliament had not passed the Declaratory Act of 1766, the irrational fear that gripped Southern slaveholders regarding the institution of slavery would have never propelled them to even consider seceding from the British Empire. Without the South, would Adams in Massachusetts or the Northern colonies have had enough support to break away themselves? What if? History is full of what ifs. Think about it. How would the course of events unfolded without Somerset? What would have happened to slavery in England? Would the British colonies in North America have revolted? Without the Revolution, would slavery in North America die out sooner and last longer? Would a civil war have occurred? I am sure you can come up with dozens of questions yourself. The question remains, what if?